Hey everybody, this is Ryan Hurley, host of the Turtle Power Podcast, and what we have here is the one and only director commentary for the 1990 film Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. So this commentary was conducted by director Steven Barron and has only been released on the German Region 2 DVD release. It has not been released in the United States. So we are reproducing it here, available for all of our listeners. I do want to give a shout out to tmntfilm.com for providing the original rip. So as far as syncing the commentary with the film, go ahead and load up your Blu-ray or DVD copy of the film, and I'll give you a second to go ahead and do it. Okay, you've done it. Okay, great. You'll be able to hear the music, the background music, so you can kind of give an idea of where you need to line up the film. The film actually in the background as he's watching it is in German, so you'll hear German voices, but they're pretty quiet compared to his voice, so shouldn't have too much trouble with that. Enjoy, and for all things Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, be sure to check out the Turtle Power Podcast, turtlepowerpodcast.com.
My name is Steve Barron. Guten Tag. Ich spreche nicht or nein Deutsch, so as you can hear, so this is in English. And Ninja Turtles was a great movie for me to work on and to make, and great fun to do. And it took a little while to develop, to get the script right and pitch the tone of it in the right way, and work out a world that where these strange creatures could coexist with humans. But I think eventually in the writing we certainly got that right, and hopefully on the screen we found a happy medium. And this opening was really actually shot after the event with wallets being stolen and the setup of the kids. Because we didn't make that in the full production schedule. It was just there was a number of things we didn't quite do because we only had 7 weeks to shoot it, and we made it for a relatively low budget, really. It was $7 million at the time, and just the turtles alone, we're going to take up most of that budget. So it was pretty tight, and so you don't get a great deal of expense in it. But this was kind of... In the end, this opening scene, right up to the TV being stolen and things, was shot after the event to cover up a bigger opening that we had in terms of some shells coming out of the sewers and more going on in the sewers world, intercut with a little more... epic, I should say, stealing across New York, and it ended up being quite small and quite tight because we just didn't have the cash to pull it off that way. This was shot on a Roosevelt Island. Shredder's den was the exterior, was just across from New York. It was part of our 4-day excursion into New York, and a chance for us to use the real New York as a character in the city. But most of it was shot in North Carolina, like these interiors of the kids working out everything they've stolen and putting them together for the Shredder were all shot down in North Carolina, in Wilmington, along with most of the interiors and a fair amount of the exterior streets around the Turtles area. Again, that's WTRL is a place in Wilmington that we converted to look like the TV studio. John Fenner was the DP. Really, I thought he did a great job, and I'd worked with him on The Storyteller. In fact, a lot of the team came from John Hurt's The Storyteller, which Jim Henson executive produced, a TV series about early European folk tales. And that's where the idea that actually Antony Minghella got to recommend me to Golden Harvest to do the film, because I'd worked with animatronics and creatures doing The Storyteller, and it just seemed a natural progression to do something as bizarre, I suppose, as this idea when it first came out was extremely bizarre. A lot of people Well, the studios wouldn't touch it. It was such a strange concept. But, yeah, now it all seems, and especially in fantasies, really come to the forefront of movies, and it seems like, you know, just a fairly normal, but hopefully enjoyable experience now as a movie. Things like the fight there where the thugs were all tied up, that happening in Blackness was partly a whole schedule thing. When we put the schedule together, we just couldn't shoot it in 7 weeks, and so I just tried to make things that would take quite a long time, like that, you know, how exactly they overpowered the guys, tried to make it all happen in off camera or in the darkness, because that would certainly save on time. And I also felt it, yeah, it just adds to it. I mean, it's nice in movies when things are left to your imagination. And as the opening titles come in, you see what was built in the studios in Wilmington, in Dino De Laurentiis Studios in Wilmington. And it was, you know, pretty much a really, really great set that the design team built. Roy Forge Smith was the production designer, and we wanted to get the look of those sewers as good as possible, and so he added things like tide marks, and you know, gave it a real texture, and quite an extensive build. It was probably our most comprehensive set, even though we had April's apartment later on and everything. It was a pretty pretty big build, with, because it wasn't straight walls, it was curves, and so the timber had to work with the plastering and that sort of thing. The turtles themselves are another whole story. You know, these are guys walking along in suits that are carrying 60-pound packs of animatronics, electronics and servos in those shells, and that was really inventing technology from the beginning in terms of what Jim Henson's Creature Shop had to do. It was a big challenge, because obviously we wanted them to be free and alive, and that was pretty tough. The turtles' master, Splinter the Rat, was in some ways more conventional a puppet, because there wasn't somebody inside him. There was Kevin Clash, who was the operator. He operated Splinter from underneath, with an arm up into his neck and head. And then, as with all these characters, there were puppeteers, further puppeteers, who were dealing with blinks and eyebrows and what they call smile, which is on the edge of the mouth. And the actual jaw itself was generally inside the... it is inside Splinter, but is external for the turtles. We cast young actors that played the roles of all the turtles, and tried to go for actors, or a cross between performers and actors, really. In Leonardo, that was somebody who has actually done costume work before, whereas Raphael was Josh Pace, who'd really had never worn a big mask or gone inside a costume, and it was a new experience to him. So we did extensive castings to find the right bodies, and then and movement and performance in that way, and then extensive work to find the right puppeteers to match those and do the and get those people in sync. So offset there would be a whole lineup of puppeteers who were driving the blinks and mouths and the eyes and everything of the creatures. And they did a lot of rehearsals, obviously, with the costume guys inside the costumes, to get totally into sync. And the weird thing was, on set, you would, for their performance, the guys inside the costume would sing or say whatever it was they were doing, and the puppeteers would be performing it so that they could get their jaw movement right and the mouth and everything. So you'd get at least two voices of the same character out of sync at the same time on set. So on set it was, and in rushes, when you watched it in dailies, it was like a mess. Audio-wise, it was something that was hard. You had to just suspend your belief if you, as you have to anyway, but and just go with your instinct in terms of how it would all come together in the end. Again, we had a tank in the studio so we could get water into those sewers and keep them wet and really go for that. Obviously not where we had the skateboarding pieces. The actual performers are really looking from under the eyes. They're looking from a tiny little slit under the bandana, which I shouldn't really tell you because you can actually see it pretty clearly. And I know that from seeing people talk about the film on the net, there's a number of times where we just weren't able to hide it, and you can get a sense of it. And if you look really carefully, you would see the face of the performer somewhere in that mouth. But hopefully not too often. In those days, digital effects were very expensive, and so you couldn't really clean things up the way you can nowadays. This is the same actor who plays Michelangelo, so he's delivering a pizza to himself here. This is the exterior we shot one day, one night, with this character. And he's called, I think his name was Michelin. Sorry, I don't have that on me. But he is delivering the pizza to himself. He's inside the suit as Michelangelo in the sewers as well. So it's the same same voice as well. So what we tried to do is they were going to spend weeks and weeks and weeks inside the costume. So give them some little moment in the film where we could see their faces. When I tried to do that with all the guys in the costumes, and I think I'll be able to point most of them out as we go. Again, as we were filming, it got simpler to work with the turtles. It got easier and more fluid. Critters. They're coming out of the movie theatre and Critters was on there. There was a film a few years earlier called Critters, and we just felt that was a smarty one towards not many films that just had creatures in. This was filmed in New York. I felt, again, it was very important to have New York in as much as possible, and we couldn't. There was nothing in Carolina. I felt the edge of the park we needed before we got into the park, and then once we were in the park, we could get away with, this being North Carolina. The thing that really gave it away was there was thousands of crickets down there in the south, and audio-wise, you'd know it, so we had to clean that up. And this is actually Sam Rockwell. This was his first little scene in a movie. He's one of these two punks. Went on to become a big star. He's really good performance in this. Really enjoyed working with him. I had no idea, obviously, that he was going to become such a big star, but you could see a real talent there. And Elias Cortez, who's playing Casey Jones here, he just felt perfect when he walked in. There was quite a lot of heat on him as an actor, and he hadn't done a big film yet, and He just leapt off, out of the room straight into that comic book character of Casey Jones, and we'd lifted this really off of Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird's comic book. So they had really the first series of comics were fantastic and gave us tons of ammunition for the film. And really, this was a scene right out of one of the comic books. It was even the sports equipment. I did actually, we ended up adding the cricket. I think one of the writers we worked with, Bobby Herbeck, came over to work with me in London as we were preparing the whole thing, and he saw that I think I took him to a cricket game, and so he gave Casey Jones a cricket bat, and out comes the cricket bat there, which is not in the comic book and not in North American culture really as a game, but he stuck it in there, and it's kind of quite a nice little quirk for the movie. This again is Raphael. Josh Pace was in that suit, and as I said, he didn't really have that experience of working inside and inside costumes and things. And he found that difficult. And that's him right there in the back of the taxi. That's Josh Pace, who plays Raphael. And that was his moment on screen. He's inside the suit as well that came across the bonnet, and he's inside there. Obviously, we shot them at different times. He's a really good young actor. He's done lots of films since. He had he had quite a few problems. It was interesting because he plays a character here who's got a dark side and who isn't comfortable in his own skin, green skin. Raphael's the most troubled of the turtles, and he seemed really perfect for it. But he also had, he had trouble with living with inside that costume, and occasionally he'd get claustrophobia because the servos were right in front of their faces, and the noise and the intense enclosed feeling there would get him quite claustrophobic, and we'd have to rip the head off quickly and get him out of there, and it wasn't quick to rip off because it was all tied together and things. So he went through it, which kind of fits the character, but he did a great performance on it. The camera in this scene is actually, it's called a snorkel lens. It's a camera that shoots down onto a mirror that enables you to get really close to objects that you couldn't normally get close to, because the camera would just be too cumbersome and the lens would be too cumbersome. And I told Henson's that I wanted to do this scene where we got really, really close to the animatronics, to the creatures, and I said it would be in a dark environment, but that it would really examine them. And they were pretty frightened of it, but I think the animatronics really held up to it. This is Judith Hoag, who did a great job of April O'Neil. I just thought she had the character. She came in for the casting. There was a real energy to her that I felt belonged to April O'Neil. Danny, I seem to remember that T-shirt is a Sid Vicious T-shirt, and I'm pretty sure that idea came from the comic book as well. I'm pretty sure there was a moment when Kevin and Peter had drawn that character with that T-shirt, and we took it all the way in that. Tried to remain pretty true to the comics to the point of, actually putting some of the scenes onto film, which was really unusual at the time. People would generally reinvent the whole thing and throw away the original material, but I felt it was, strong enough to really go for it. The studios in North Carolina was actually right under a flight path that to the local military airport, and so sometimes we would be shooting a scene where the turtles' faces would, radio controlled by the puppeteers who were a few yards away, and the radio signals from a plane landing would send the face of the turtles into completely involuntary and inappropriate spasms. It was very funny. Obviously, if the light was fading or the producers were saying we got to move on, it wasn't that funny. But it was something that we didn't had no idea would affect us. But who would know until you actually do it. A little bit of rubber suit on Raphael there. You get those moments where those hands become a bit rubbery and the shell dents in and shows off its rubber form. As I say, I think that Henson's did such a great job of, without them, this film would have been really nothing, because it was all about the turtles and selling that and imbuing them with character and a feel of tangibility and reality, and that was really important. Yeah, this is part of the movie where turtles are wanting to make contact with April, and I can see a little bit of the eye hole under the bandana again, but It's funny looking back at it after all this time. It's some good memories. This was a subway scene, and we were allowed in our, again, in our 4 days in New York, I had a choice of what I could shoot, and I felt to try and build a subway station would be a nightmare. There was obviously nothing in Wilmington, and this was one that was available for use from the New York City Film Department, one that was only used for a few hours a day, so we could use it, I think, through the night. We ended up using this. And pretty expensive. Most of our budget went into turtles and shooting in New York, but it just kept very much the flavor we wanted. That little charge together, I used it a few times in the movie. I was quite fond of shooting at different film, different camera speeds, and in that moment, we probably shot at 2 frames a second and kept everyone fairly still as he charged towards the foot members. And then also, even when he's fighting, any of them are fighting, I'd just swap around, because you're normally at 24 frames per second in film. And sometimes we drop to 23 or 22, because like this walk of Raphael through the sewers, it can be, with the weight on his back and everything, it can be a little too slow. So he just trimmed it up a little, run at 23 frames a second, made it a tiny bit faster. And then when the kicks happened and the faces and things, we'd go to 22 frames occasionally to just get the speed of the, you know, get their muscles really pushing them through, propelling them through the air. Here we're back in the turtle's den. And they brought Raphael back to the den, and this is one of the few times you see Splinter's feet, which was a different rig to his upper body. His upper body had to have Kevin Clash underneath with his hand into his head. And in fact, the whole set here for the puppeteers is actually built up 4 feet above the studio floor, so you could have puppeteers under the floor at all times, in particular for Splinter, but also for the turtles. It was a good way of getting cables, any cables we had to attach to them under the floor and out that way, and there would be puppeteers down there looking at TV monitors and able to see what was going on through the camera, but not what physically is happening live on set. Again, this is very much taken from the comic book, this scene, when very, very much how April O'Neil first reacted in comic book number one, probably, I think it was, to the turtles and their world. It was absolutely boiling inside those suits for those turtles. It was, I think all the performers lost at least 20 pounds each during the production. They all got so skinny, and it was quite an art piece off the set, where you'd get them resting. We would take, you know, if we had to set up from one shot to another, we'd get their heads off them so that they could breathe, and they would sit on these horses that were made of wood and rest in a certain way that wasn't too heavy on their backs. These flashbacks to the early stories of the turtles growing up and the ewes and the whole backstory were shot on Super 8, which is, you know, obviously very grainy. I just wanted to get that retro look, and a lot of it was done. Brian Henson, Jim Henson's son, was a second unit director. So these were very tricky, time-consuming shots with those real turtles running out of the can, and the puppeteering of the young Splinter and the young turtles growing up there. That was all very time consuming, and so we put that onto second unit, and he did it all on a Super 8 camera, which the producers were slightly freaked out about, because there was no cover for that. You know, you were shooting on Super 8, sending it to the chemist almost to get it developed, and it wasn't very professional looking, but I think it worked for the look of the flashbacks. think what really worked in terms of the puppeteers and their performance and being able to put across these characters was the humanity, and that what is what made them work with the characters, the human characters in the film, and because that was always going to be difficult. I mean, you know, when you're planning it or reading it, you know, a normal woman walking along with four Ninja Turtles and the way they looked was always going to be a tough sell, but you buy it because of their humanity, and that's a big credit to Jim Henson and the creatures that they created and the way they managed and puppeteered them. The manhole covers that were built on the streets there, really, they had to be built. We couldn't use a real street here because these turtles were too big to get through a normal manhole, a regular one even in New York. They're just too small. They couldn't have got fitted through. So we were always going to have to build them. And then we dug under the set. This was a New York set that was in the back lot that we revamped from other movies that were made there at the De Laurentiis studio. And then we dug down and found water, actually. They went 15 feet below ground, but it was more, they kept flooding, so we had to pump them out as well as have enough space for turtles to be down there and come out from. Then we're back inside the studio. We built this whole apartment for April because, well, as you see later, it gets trashed, so that was the way to do it. And again, also, any real location shooting with the puppeteering is very difficult because you've got a big team of people all around. And we had to build a set up again four feet off the ground to get underneath and run these creatures. Because where they can, we've got them actually wired in. There's a wire coming going up to their bottom and getting up under the shell. And that is a more accurate way of running the servos that control their mouth movement. And those servos, no one had used anything as fast as that in animatronics before this. Servos had been used, but they had to move so quickly for speech. So that was a first. A lot of things were a first here, and to get it done. I think here's another moment where the camera undercranks, which means reduces speed and goes down to, I think it was 6 frames per second here, really to get across the anxiety of Raphael. This was the camera dropping in speed as it came round and round and round. That was new technology at the time, now very common now. But that was new technology that you could do that, reduce the speed with also changing the aperture and that sort of thing. Again, important for this scene, the character of these four turtles now being a little bit different without their master. They've always grown up and been dependent on Splinter, and now he's gone, and they have to deal with that. And performance-wise, that was a transition for them all, which I thought they really pulled off. New York shots that just kept the flavour of New York in there. Just in trying to sell the film initially, to be made, to, you know, as a producer as well, I was part producing it, and I went down to Cannes the year before we filmed it, and tried to pitch it to everyone. And actually, funnily enough, we got a German sale. They got it. And so did the French, and that kicked us off. At least gave us some of the money in pre-sales to get going on the builds with the Henson creatures and things. And then we took it to America, thinking we'd get a U.S. deal. And everywhere we took it, every studio said, "No, that sounds ridiculous. Teenage Mutant what?" They wouldn't even read it, some of them. It just couldn't get past the title page because it was sounded like what they called a trauma film, which was a studio that did very strange giant tomatoes and odd things from outer space. And we couldn't convince them that it was whether it was something that was much more, that could become much more commercial. And at the time, the cartoon had just appeared on the TV at 6 in the morning on a Sunday morning, and little kids were watching it. If the studio execs were 4-year-old kids, we'd have got the deal straight away, but they weren't, and they weren't watching them watch it, so they couldn't tell that there was an audience that was going to work for it. And it was really hairy. It was touch and go. We got to North Carolina to begin production, and you know, we just didn't have a U.S. deal, and that meant we really didn't have the money. Even the $7 million, we just didn't have it. And at the very last minute, New Line Cinema stepped in and said, you know, that's worth a punt. We'll buy it for America for $2 million. While we were making the film, the cartoon just grew and grew in popularity, and we got further and further with thinking that we might be, you know, have something that could do really well. And we had no idea of the popularity when the movie came out. It was unreal in terms of, I was in LA at the time, and people were, in the weeks leading up to it, were reacting to the trailer and leaping out of their seats and clapping, and it felt like, you know, we just hit a moment, and a moment of time, and a very different film for people who were looking for a different film, and kids who just love these characters. And that's Sam Rockwell there, just at the front there. We know him now from Moon and one other, what, Green Mile, wonderful films, movies he's done. The film just went from strength to strength, and opening weekend it made $25 million at the box office, which was, doesn't sound a lot, but it was an enormous, compared with the size of the movie. And it was an independent movie, and New Line were an independent company at the time. And it went on to make $135 million at the U.S. box office, which is, for a long time, was the most any independent film had ever made, until Blair Witch came along. And so, it, you know, looking back, you can see it, but at the time it was very hard to sell it to people as an idea that could be a great franchise and things. We used a lot of the ninja fighting. We used a team from Hong Kong, Golden Harvest, who produced the film, who initially bought the rights from Eastman and Laird. They're a Hong Kong-based company who'd done a fair amount of films, including some Bruce Lee productions and Jackie Chan. And they, you know, they sort of handed it over to us creatively in terms of producing it, but they gave us some great leads on people that would be good for the ninja fighting. And they came over from Hong Kong, a really great stunt coordinator who's credited on the film, and worked with our US stunt man, and did a pretty fantastic job, actually. They were it was a whole different attitude to the US stunt people, in terms of what they would do and how they would do it, and their fitness and their level of fighting was just incredible. They, you know, at no time would anything be too difficult for them, and they would really lay their body on the line for the film. In fact, a couple of them actually got injured. They didn't speak any English, so we had a translator, and each one of them did what, you know, each one of the turtles, so that we carried that sequence, and then they would also supervise all these sequences, the demonstrations that Shredder is now about to do on his ninja prowess. We tried to stay very true to the ninja, the culture of ninja, and its meaning of channeling energy from within, and the, you know, silence, really. In Japanese culture, that was the ninja, where it was invisible, was so in tune with the universe that he could move without being seen or heard. Lots of kids there from the local Carolina, schools and things. We got quite a few extras and brought them down to a factory just outside of Wilmington, which again is supposed to be just across the river in New York. And it just worked on the right levels. I can't remember what the factory was for, but it was definitely abandoned, but it kept a lot of its features that we could use without building a big set, because we didn't have the budget to do that. With Splinter, you see the amount of water in his eyes there. I would constantly ask the puppeteers and the creature shop to add more. I was always pushing that, because I felt the more you had in those eyes, the more we believed it. And it was a little bit of a fight, because he's made of latex, and you kind of destroy the latex, even if you put, you know, water-based glycerin on those eyes. It just slowly eats away at the latex. But I feel it was, you know, really worth it, and they did as well, just to really make that character live. I can't stress how much I owe my involvement in this film to Anthony Minghella, the late great Anthony Minghella, who won the Oscar for English Patient and did many other movies, because he was approached by Golden Harvest about doing another project, and they showed him this comic book of Ninja Turtles, and they said, "This is a very strange thing. They had no idea how to do it, but did they know anyone who might?" And he pointed it, you know, my way. He immediately saw that you need somebody with that sort of thinking to make it, and he put me onto them, and obviously I was really grateful, because at the time I'd done one movie, Electric Dreams, and was really, you know, I was being asked to do mainly music because of my background in music videos, many music films, and not very interesting things as well. And something, I was always looking for something that was different, and you couldn't have got more different than this. It just made it. That say that just flew through to Donatello's legs. That's the sort of shot that you need to. We did it in camera and ran a little invisible wire with a sigh kind of coming down the barrel of that wire, so it would stay in the right direction, not endanger anyone. This is where Raphael and Josh Pace, who's inside the suit, really pulls off what he needs to pull off here, which is the breakup of this group of brothers. Without their master Splinter, they're lost, and in particular him, and it puts pressure on their leader Leonardo and Raphael, who's already a little schizophrenic and capable of going off the rails. It puts him out of whack. And in this case, where he's cartwheeling and jumping along that roof, this was a rooftops in New York, which, you know, again, we wanted to keep the New York feel. And that's our Hong Kong-based stuntman in a much lighter suit with a much lighter backpack with no animatronics in it, because they don't need the facial movement. So that face couldn't move, it couldn't smile, it couldn't talk, it couldn't blink. But it didn't need to. It would just pull off everything else. And now we go to the back to the suits that really can do everything. And inside his backpack is 60 pounds of animatronics. So there was always, each shot was a different method or a different suit or a different performer even inside to put across what needed to be put across. With the writer Todd Langan, we were always looking for moments of irony to get some comedy into it, and obviously the turtles all watching the tortoise and the hare is a bit extreme, but felt it worked, and just bought the rights to the classic cartoon that we thought would work with that. They're kids, they're teenagers, and I think that was what we had to keep remembering. Yeah, they've got all those muscles all over them. That kind of goes away from that feel, but they are teenagers. Back on the roof, the fight is really, as it intercuts with these scenes, it's really something that we did in the studio. We had another big set and a big build, and that was the hardest one to match, I think. That exterior roof with the exterior shots of New York from earlier were, you know, were a different vibe. They were slightly, obviously, studio to real exterior. It's a tough match, especially when you're not cutting inside. You know, you're staying on the same location. We used a big backdrop that was a photograph, a massive camera photograph of New York that just helped it. And then quite a few stunts. What we would try and do is we would shoot what we can on main unit because of our 7-week schedule, and we'd have, you know, the main actors come into a situation like these guys all coming into the store and take it as far as we could. And then as these turns into fights and these scenes became more about stunts and things, we would hand it over to second unit. So these moments here, probably falling on the ground and the being kicked and everything, we would have to go over to second unit, who'd carry on with the sets once we'd on the main unit began the destroying of them. We'd be there with the main unit shooting the first entrance there of Raphael coming down, smashing through the skylight, and the first members of the foot coming through, and then, you know, what we could, if there was any dialogue, we'd shoot it on main unit, but there would be a lot of second unit work left over in terms of kicking and fighting and things. I think this was quite a big moment in the trailer. Got lots of laughs. Was the nunchuck scene, which became a problem in certain countries of the world. I'm not sure about Germany, but I know in the UK, the nunchucks were a problem. They felt that it was too violent for kids. They felt that the word ninja was a little too violent as well. So Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles in the UK became Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles, which I felt was a bit silly, but I didn't have much say in the matter. You know, I felt that it was all about, you know, with these fights and things, and obviously young kids seeing this. I felt it was much more the swashbuckling Three Musketeers. You know, they run around in those stories and have, you know, always for children through the decades and centuries have heard tales of knights and swordplay, and I felt it was an extension of that, and it wasn't mean spirited, and it had you know, a real atmosphere of, you know, that was light and fun, and that, you know, compensated. It's not like what I look at some of the computer games of today and think, well, has that in any way moved people to violence or kids to violence? And I think sometimes it does, and I don't think I can put my hand on my heart and think, I didn't feel it was that way with this film, and the spirit of it, I don't think it attracted everyone to go out and be bad. Again, we're really destroying the set bit by bit. So we'd, as I say, come onto it for a day or two and then give it to second unit and come back onto it. And that was obviously a one-taker with the floor collapse. That would have killed us if that didn't work first time. So you had to hope that those things did. And those stunt guys coming down through that roof, that is, you know, that's a pretty heavy stunt to do, because that's a good 12-foot drop, and there might be, you know, good soft cushioning on the floor, but it's still a big drop to do, and not easy, and can be dangerous. And the guys from Hong Kong were amazing at all this stuff, and a great spirit. You'd come to work and they're you know, everybody was smiling. We had a very happy crew, and you know, in between setups or whatever, you know, they do little pieces where one of the turtles would just break into some bizarre little ditty of a song, and you know, it'd be good fun. It would always be it would be good fun. We were making a little weird little indie film that that we had no idea what it would become, but it was good fun to do it. And this is Elias Cortez coming back as Casey Jones, coming back into the story, and it's sort of pointing towards Raphael's, you know, missing and needed, and they've always worked as a team of four, and now here comes Casey Jones to fill in the fourth member of the team and really take the place of Raphael through that little moment in the story and get the team back working. Fire made it all the more difficult, really, just the heat that was coming off of those are burners that are done by gas, and you can kind of turn them up and then quickly turn them off after a take, but the heat that it generates, and these guys are already pretty hot in these suits and things, so it was pretty tough for them, and you had to shoot quick, and one or two takes wherever we could, it was just really grab that take and know that in the editing we could get around any awkwardness and move on. And the editing, really, Sally Menke was the editor, and it was one of her first movies, and she did an amazing job, and she went on to edit for Tarantino through all his movies. Actually, I don't think he's done a movie without her, and she's never available now, if ever. But this was just about her first film, and I thought she did a great job of cutting it together, and often it was not easy because, you know, we just had to get out with what we had. And that wide shot of the burning building, for instance, talk about getting out with what we had. We, you know, we were getting into post-production there, and the budget was, no one was going to give us any more towards the budget. So my intention with that shot was always that in the background would be the rest of New York at night. And that was a digital effects shot, which in those days would have cost about $25,000, which was so much to us that we couldn't get it. And I did actually take the film along kind of quietly, and I got in a bit of trouble for it, but I took the film quietly to Jeffrey Katzenberg at Disney at the time, because I'd cut it together after 6 or 7 weeks, and I just felt it was all these little bits that we didn't get time to shoot, and those extra pieces that I would have loved to have had another week shooting to really upgrade the movie, that little extra. And he liked the film, and he asked me to, you know, to get involved in it, and but in the end, it wasn't possible, and we never got to do our extra few days shooting, and I never got my digital effects where they were. But you know what? Maybe they weren't necessary, because, you know, now you look at it, and it is what it is, and you know, you just accept it for what it is. And and I think sometimes the restrictions are a benefit, because you just don't go into everything. You see films have so much in them now. It's so much like a big box of chocolates full of richness that can overboil it. And this was the sort of bare trimmings, but where you're there, the time is spent on character. This rat, you know, is an incredible character, and I think it is a character that will live, especially for kids at that time, or the adults who grew up and were kids at this time, will remember that they're believing and living with these characters. And that was a big part of the fun. Kevin Clash is an amazing puppeteer, and it's his voice as well, who's grown up and worked on Sesame Street and with the Henson creatures for many years, and he was just born to be Splinter too, and he did such a great job with him. I think we added, I don't think it was in the original comic books, but we added the ear being torn off of Splinter from his past. For story reasons, it really kind of hooked up, as you can see through the film. Now, this is the house that they run away to, which is supposed to be, you know, within traveling distance of New York. So it's a little bit of a cheat because we're obviously out in Carolina here because that's where we were, and we found an abandoned house and the relocation people found it and we could use it, and you know, we made it a little, we roughed it up a bit more and got it into a bit more of a state. But it is, if you live within 3 hours of New York, you probably wouldn't find it quite like that. But it worked for what it was, and it was straight out of the comic book again, volume 2, I think it was, that of the original story, where they have the big fight at the antique store and then run to the country and recuperate and try and figure out how they're going to get their master back. And this is where the relationship really between Elis Cortez and Judith Hogel, April and Casey, really grows. And we got into a bit of human interaction and performance, and I thought the two of them played off each other really well, actually. And Todd had written some really good dialogue. Todd Langan, the writer, had written some really good dialogue for them, and it just seemed to gel. It was a nice few days of shooting out there. Pretty hot, because we were, you know, down south there. It's it can get very hot and sweaty, but it was good fun to do. And some years ago, I'd done a music video some years before this for Aha, Take On Me, and it was an animation, live action to animation drawing, and I still had it in my mind, and so, you know, as you tend to repeat yourself, I just ended up thinking, you know, why doesn't April draw, and why not use some little moments that kind of give a nod towards the comic book and have these characters, see them as drawn characters as well, and do it that way. Really nice lighting again. I think John Fenner, I've said it already, but I think he did an amazing job. He gave a little bit of a European sensibility to it, because it comes across as an American film, and I suppose you don't really expect it to be directed by a British director. A lot of people were surprised by that, and an English DP, and that really gave it, I feel, gave it, you know, that European edge, which was not that common in the movies that were more on the commercial family front. It's a moment as well in the film. This reflects, you know, a moment where, you know, we can be more tender with the characters and really work with their relationships and spend some time and live with them away from the mayhem of fighting and rebuild them. Yeah, Elis Cortez is really looks like a young Robert De Niro, we all felt at the time, and he sounds like him as well to a degree, but he went on to a really strong career after this. He went to the Terrence Malick film that was nominated, and quite, you've seen him in many, many other things, and always, he did number two. I didn't do Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2 and 3. Here comes a little pratfall about to happen in this little moment, which gets a laugh, but it's a cheap laugh, obviously. Things collapsing, but yeah, two and three. I didn't work on them. I mean, I felt once I'd done one, it was you know, it was just going to repeat itself to do another. And I know they changed April, but kept Casey Jones as for quite some time after that. And,
okay, Leo, trick dich wieder ein. Ganz ruhig bleiben, ja? Hör mal, Raffi.
And this is a sweet scene of a reconciliation between Leonardo and Raphael. And
du weißt, dass wir dich nicht brauchen und all der Käse so. Leo.
And now these guys have got to keep together. Kodak moment line was straight out of a series of TV commercials, which would run the commercial and then get into the Kodak moment, and so we pulled that straight out of American TV. The look of the exteriors there was just really done with a straw filter, just that kind of it puts across that warm look, a straw coloured, I suppose, and just gives it a nice cinematic edge. We storyboarded a lot of the film, actually. I've got hundreds of drawings and boards that were pretty accurate. If you look at the storyboards now, you can see how it related to the actual shooting. A lot of it was, you know, we went by those boards. And a lot of them were done by Brendan McCarthy, somebody I'd worked with quite a bit at that time and since. And he's from that comic book world. And I thought what was happening at that time really was, even though there weren't that many comic books being made into movies, it felt like the influence of those comic books and those artists coming into movies and designing and storyboarding was definitely there. When I discovered him, I went away from the conventional storyboard artists and more into those comic book artists, because that's what they did, really. You know, when you saw the panels going panel to panel, they're telling a story, and so they learned the craft of storyboarding in a different way that kind of came out of comics. And I thought that was a massive asset to this film. And later I did Coneheads and a few other films with Brendan, and his sensibility was always had a positive effect on the film. Of course, Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird were, you know, tremendously involved in the film. They really were excited about making a film, had never been around a film before, and I went up to Northampton in Massachusetts, where they lived and where they had created the Turtles, and I spent quite a lot of time up there with them, talking through what the film would be like and how it would work. And once they started seeing the maquettes, the actual miniature models of the characters, and they really got excited about their dream coming alive. This is a moment with Leonardo and Splinter connecting through meditation on the astral plane almost. And we talked about doing more in that sort of astral plane world, but we didn't in the end. Trivial Pursuit, I think I played it all that Christmas before that, and I was like, let's do something ridiculous, like one of these questions for the Turtles. It was just while we were developing the script, and I just felt, I don't know why, but I don't know where they get a Trivial Pursuit from. It just got in there and sat there.
Leo, wenn du uns wegen nichts hier rausgeschleppt hast, dann macht euch keine Sorgen.
So this is, yeah, more of a moment. Again, there's always a gag, the marshmallows gag, but it's kind of a serious moment where these turtles are coming together and trying to connect with Master Splinter. And that is sort of, you know, it's a sort of fascinating part that could be explored more, I think, in the Turtles franchise of the future, is what goes on with that universal connection, and how many levels of you can contact people, on what level, and whether they are, whether they're like radio waves, really, where you can kind of, when you have a hunch about something, you feel something and connect with someone. One of the few actual effects we did on the film, it's just really a kind of soft mix. Again, really could have done something very special nowadays, but very basic here, as a fairly straightforward post effect.
Kraft ist dieselbe, die mich heute Nacht
when we were filming we watch rushes and dailies, as they call them in the States, and I really enjoyed the level of lighting and the darkness of it, and felt that was right. But we did get a lot of notes from the studio, in particular the Hong Kong studio, who were very frightened that we were making it too dark, and that kids wanted it bright and colourful, and we were constantly getting notes, and I caught somebody talking to the DP, talking to John Fenner, and saying, it's got to be lighter, it's got to be brighter, you've got to brighten it up and everything, and I seriously fought that, because I felt that, we'd grown up with Grimm's fairy tales more ancient fairy tales, and that kids really can take it when it's when it goes into blackness, and when they have to imagine it for themselves, and where it's not all bright and shiny and colourful. And so I really fought that, because I felt also, if there's one story that you were trying to get across about, it was that these turtles came from the sewers, and here we come back to the sewers, and that's where it's all dark and black, and that's how they've grown up, and they come out at night, and so I felt it belonged to the film. The rain here was a problem, obviously, with the contraptions and all the radio controlled stuff, but we had to be very careful, because it had to be pouring, and big rain towers and everything, and these guys got pretty wet inside their suits, but they're always careful with that. We tested a lot of these sort of actions, and knowing that we were going to go in the rain and things, and we were testing a lot in London before we even moved to North Carolina, and near the Henson studio we ran into it as an old churchyard where we had Leonardo, an early prototype Leonardo, tumbling through the grass and that. And London's notorious for the rain, and so we got to test it there first, and it rained on us, and we still kind of stood up, the paint jobs and everything, because constantly touching up parts of the turtles as well in terms of color, and the latex arms and the latex faces would constantly deteriorate and fall apart, and for every Leonardo, there would be 10 sets of arms and, a few different heads. Not so much with the robotic animatronics, because they are, they were one-offs, really, but the replacements of other parts of the body were quite plentiful. Big latex department producing all that latex for us. We brought as well about 30 crew from London, from the Hensons, it was a big part of it that these guys had all worked together on many other things, from Labyrinth to Dark Crystal. They'd kind of grown up heading towards this, never quite this technology, but getting very close in the molds and the latex and that sort of thing. But they were very experienced. They all came and lived in North Carolina, which was a great place to actually make this film, because it was so quiet. I mean, I remember driving to work every day. It would take 18 minutes, and there was no rush hour in this little town of Wilmington, and if there was one, I didn't notice it, and stayed on the beach, not far from the studio, had a little boat there. It makes it sound like I had lots of time to muck about, but we were pretty busy, but it was a very comfortable existence away from a big city. It kind of made for a happier film, I think, than if we'd have shot it in a big metropolis like London or LA. We were a bit more hick about it and a bit more local, and we're on our own. We weren't, no one came there and interfered, so that was all pretty useful too. Film obviously relied heavily on sponsorship. Domino's Pizza stepped in and gave us a big deal which was a massive part of it, and helped with the financing and really built up Domino's as well, because they, you know, they didn't know they had such a big hit on their hands, and they didn't know that, you know, they would end up increasing massively the sales of pizza. Every kid who saw this movie went home and ordered pizza immediately, and or on the way home, or, you know, it became a big issue, and there were Turtles pizzas, there was a Donatello pizza and a Raphael pizza, and they all stayed around for a number of years. And the toys too were enormous sales. I know my kids were about 8 and 7 at the time, and I bought them some Ninja Turtles plastic tricycles, and they just played on those for month after month after month, and obviously loved all the toy figurines and everything that came out of the movie. And were obviously delighted to be on the set as well, because they got to be hugged by Donatello and got to know all the characters involved in creating and performing in the film. This again is a Shredder's Den. Now, the whole idea really of the Shredder and the kids wasn't in the comic books. This was an idea. I felt there was another thread to the movie that had to be brought in to drive the story. And I'd read about a little article someone had sent me in the Philadelphia Examiner, I think it was, about a character who was a modern-day Fagin from Oliver Twist, who had all these kids out stealing for him. But they weren't just stealing because they were frightened of him. They were stealing because, you know, what they could steal and what they could get out of it was something that was very interesting for them. So the idea was, you know, very much that that the Shredder keeps them entertained with everything that they would possibly want, and has them on the hook in that way. This again is now going back in the scene between Danny and Splinter, going back to flashback, and the Super 8 footage. This tiny little camera on top of a big camera crane, and a dolly. It looked pretty hysterical. I haven't got any pictures, but it was always very funny to put a little kind of a home camera on a big movie set. The backstory is quite involved, actually, and one day I think Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird want to do an origin tale which really focuses on that backstory, that involved backstory. I think we added the ear being cut off. I'm pretty sure that was our invention for story reasons, but most of it is pretty accurate. And there's Sid Vicious on the front of Danny's t-shirt, and really there was a connection there as well, because for a while I was going to and I did some meetings and work with Malcolm McLaren, who was the manager of the Sex Pistols, and I think I knew him quite well at the time, and was very interested in an album he'd put out, which was classical music, kind of given a bit of a kick of a modern twist, and in that kind of slightly punk vibe. And I had an early cut somewhere, I'm sure it still exists somewhere, where it was set to McLaren's music and classical Blue Danube and these real classical orchestral pieces with this driving beat behind them. And it's quite sophisticated. It's probably too sophisticated in a way, although, you know, looking back, it would be great to have tried that. I kind of ended up with the music going much more obviously towards the commercial feel and away from something as eccentric as that. But it was, that's why I kind of pushed the Danny and the Sid Vicious and the Sex Pistols thing, was because I wanted to get McLaren involved in some way, and I think he got us the permissions and clearances for those shirts and things, and punk was something that was very much in my past. I'd worked with a new quite a few of the new wave, the Jam, and and the Clash and a few of those bands, and wanted to again naturally bring some of that into these kids and into this rebellious goings on. Here again, we're diving into what we have built, and I think they look pretty good, actually. The manhole covers and the drains and things above the ground were as hard as those, you know, creating those sets below the ground because of the earth in North Carolina. And I did remember going there one day and opening up those manhole covers, and it just water just poured out of it, and we had to come back and shoot another day. Here again, we're back to, you know, how do we do another fight, which would take us and the main unit a day or two, and would take the second unit two or three days to clean up. And we, you know, with an overall production schedule of those 7 weeks, there's just no way we could fit it in. So where it was blackness earlier in the film, it's steam here that can cover up the fight itself and let us imagine it and keep the schedule makeable and doable. Often film is a compromise of money versus art, I suppose. And you fight for it to look as good as possible, but you have to be responsible and make it fit what the mechanisms of the finance demand it to fit. Another little fight sequence here. We wrote in the script the sort of story of these fights, but didn't really go into the detail of the actual happenings. And then there were, in the week leading into production, there were discussions on each of the fights. And, I'd storyboarded some of it and had some ideas in there. But then when we got together with the Hong Kong stuntmen, we really worked out what would be possible and added the angles of what they felt would sell the hits and the fights and things. So by the time we got on the set, we knew what we were doing, and we re-storyboarded to fit that. I think Kevin and Peter had done really well in creating, obviously, all these characters. We didn't really add new characters to the movie, but Casey Jones, I think, is my favorite, maybe because he's a sports freak, but he just is he's just a character that really holds the film together, I think, as a somebody you want to, you know. There's always, when you see a film that you enjoy, I think there's a character that you just can't wait for him to come back in on screen and stuff. And with these action sequences of skateboarding, we had, I can't remember his name, but I'm sure it's on the credits, the skateboarding expert who did those pieces was amazing. He could just, I mean, he'd come in and do all these incredible things. I mean, put the suit on him, it'd obviously get a bit harder, but he'd still pull it off. And just going back to characters he always wanted to come back on the screen, Sam Rockwell, who's there, that's the young Sam Rockwell with the... probably his first beard, actually, he became a character that in the way that Elias Cortez is doing in this film, as someone that you enjoyed being with, and you kept him away for a few scenes, and then you really wanted to come back to him. Makes such a difference when you can get these young, cool actors. And he came out of New York, and the casting lady, who Lynn Kressel, her name was, cast later, did I worked on Merlin and Arabian Nights and a bunch of other big Hallmark shows, did a great job, and just found that talent that before it had broken, and she was you know, so good at that. Getting people on the set that you could really trust to pull off a performance. Is more trailer type dialogue. I seem to remember these sort of quips being in the trailer. That was the, you know, the fun of it, fight and quip, and then, you know, another joke and then a bit more fighting, and that's how they grew up. And I mean, it's pretty incredible what Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird did with them, these four turtles, because, you know, they definitely were so thought out as characters, and in fact, in the original comic books, they were all wore the same colour bandana, a red bandana. And so you couldn't really, on first sight, you couldn't say, well, that's four turtles. They could all be the same person. But they then worked extra specially hard to, you know, obviously give them all these different characteristics that, that you know, things they would do and say that then distinguish them. And in going through that process, they were so well drawn. By the time we got to our film, and it was felt that they needed to have, you know, more a different identity than that. And the colours, Playmates Toys, who were going to release the toys, just said that it couldn't sell four different turtles if they've all got the same look and things. So, you know, that became an issue. And so we ended up with the different colour bandanas. But the different characters had already been drawn by Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird, very much so. And this is our moment of first viewing of the Shredder by the turtles. There's a shot. We used a camera operator called Mike Brewster, who very really good at staging and tracking and movement and things. And he does a lovely tracking shot right into the Shredder as the Shredder turns into the camera. That I always remember being really impressed by, and how he staged it and you know, made it happen. That's coming up. Match for it? Again, the gags with we call that car cock in England. That paper, scissors, stone. I'm back out on the streets. We're back in the we're back on this set in North Carolina at the De Laurentiis Studios. It was used for a movie, a big Man in Little China, I think it was called, and it was built for that, and it was a fairly big street for a build, and it deteriorated quite a bit, but we were able to revamp it. Otherwise, there's that shot from Mike Brewster with the turn for the Shredder, but. We would have been really seriously in trouble. I don't know quite how we would have made the film without that street, and it was big enough to really give us so much of the movie. We've seen it a lot in different scenes and things, and you know, we couldn't have done it on the real streets because of all the problems with the drains and everything, and we absolutely had to have it in a controlled environment, and there was no other option. It was really, you know, one of those fates of right time, right place that made this movie possible. Todd is so clever at the little one-liners. Again, another one for Elias Cortez here. And he came from television. He, as a writer, had done The Wonder Years, and so he was used to really kind of hitting the right moment and right comic timing and continuous pace from television. And I think that really helped us with our scenes and the shape of the scenes. We spent 3 months at the Mondrian Hotel in L.A. really kind of fine-tuning the script. And I think it came down one time. I actually was sitting by the pool for a moment, and he came down and he acted out this final confrontation and said, look, I think this is it. And it was the Shredder, and he was Splinter, and he was turtles, and he acted it all out, and it's one of those moments where you look across the other side of the swimming pool and there's all these LA types and they're all looking at him like, what the hell is going on there? But what was going on there is now going on here on the screen, and he certainly was a major part of it. I saw the film at Tribeca recently, and it was at a big outdoor festival, and it was the 20th anniversary of the movie, and it was wonderful to see. There was about 2,000 people there, and New Yorkers and big fans of Turtles, and they were just cheering every line and every character, and they knew it word by word, and it just it really struck me. I hadn't really seen that over these, you know, the ensuing decades. I hadn't really seen how it had stayed with people, and it was very warming to see that. Here's our final moment with the Shredder. That final confrontation. That was a tricky shot, that high shot. And obviously we needed to do a big stunt here. Dropped into the, as I'm sure you've all seen on makings of, masses of boxes, cardboard boxes. I think that was a one-taker. I suppose if I was to do the Turtles again today, the approach would be a little bit different. I mean, I love that they're there on the set, and they're there, and they're hugging their master there, and that they are really with us, and they're lit by the same real lighting instead of the CG thing. I find it a little hard to relate and engage in CG characters generally. I mean, I think Gollum in Lord of the Rings is probably an exception, but I think probably what I would do is use a combination, is maybe the turtle suits that really do touch the ground and really do touch and feel and move around, and then possibly add the faces and the eyes and the mouth and allow that to be the things that we add in post and use modern technology to push it up a level. I think movies like Where the Wild Things are kind of heading that way, where they're going back to the Henson spirit and the Henson warmth and characterization, and then just using the CGI to just take you back to more believable. Pretty soon after the film came out, 3 months later, I got called into Steven Spielberg's office, and I'd never met him, and you know, never gone near him, and had a really nice meeting with him. He actually asked me to do a film, which I probably stupidly turned down, which was Casper the ghost story. And he said that him and his boy, I can't remember how old he was, maybe 10 at the time, had watched Ninja Turtles 3 times, and he loved it, and he thought it was so different and special, and you know, he wanted to work with me, and I really obviously wanted to work with him. And I think I was probably at the stage where I wasn't quite. I wanted to, yeah, which you are as a director, you kind of want to move on, you don't want to repeat yourself. So we didn't quite find the project, but that was the sort of impact a film like this can, you know, have on your career, especially when it makes so much money at the box office. Oh, Casey, hi. There was it really did very well all around the world. I think Germany to France. I remember being carried along by the four turtles at the Champs-Élysées on the front cover of some French newspaper, and it really changed and pushed, you know, me onto another level. It's quite shocking, actually. I think, in a way, when something like that is so big. I'm watching now and remembering being on the set of this as we were making it, and we were making a movie, and we, you know, we didn't know we were making something that I would be sitting 20 years later talking about, or doing a commentary for, or that people would still be revisiting, and that would be being made as more sequels and being bought in the shops and stores still. It was nothing like that. It was so far removed from that as we were doing it. But it was, you know, it's just, I suppose, things, the stars have to align, things have to connect, and everything has to come together. And with this, it certainly seemed to. So thank you very much, and Dankeschön, I should say, for listening, and I hope I was able to give you some sort of insight into what it was like to make it. Obviously, it was a long time ago for me, and a lot of memories are coming back as I'm watching it, as I'm talking to you, and obviously one of those memories is Jim Henson and his Creature Shop, and Jim was such an amazing character, and you know, I just can't say enough about him, and would like to pay tribute to him and what he has done for most children across the world, really, with all his the Muppets and Sesame Street and everything. He was such a special, special man, and very grateful that, you know, he came along and did this, because there was a moment where he felt that this, you know, might not be in Henson's spirit, and then when he saw what we were doing, he was right on board, and very sweet and giving, and Tim Minghella as well, who's also sadly passed away. Just like to pay tribute to those two wonderful men, and thank you, and goodbye.
There's a power in the feeling, a power in the sound.